Good evening, gentlemen and ladies. Welcome to the full council meeting at Borough Estate and Council. Tony Griffiths, I'm the deputy mayor. Sadly, as you probably understand, that our mayor passed away, and this is the first full council meeting since that particular event. And I think it would be right for if we just stand for a very short while, just to in memory of the deceased and sympathy for the bereaved. Thank you very much. So on that note,
And it's a very emotional one because we lost our chair. I'm just stepping in, so we're going to be carrying on with the charities which might be. And thanks for all the support. And I hope we will be able to complete that note. Okay, so because I know that the agenda is so huge, so we'll start with the victims that way. So the charities, as I mentioned, will be the St. Peter's Hospital. But one of the things which I thought of mentioning is during my term, we could actually finish off with the underway. And the other one was a multi-grade gathering, which we thought for the town. But I don't know whether we'll be able to do it, but we'll try our best to do it if possible. And so we can actually finish off. Okay, so the election of vice chair. Okay, so that's right now the important thing, the submissions from the public. So anybody want the public?
Bring forward the 73 bus item on the agenda.
Any other submissions?
If people have got things to say about the 73, do you want them to say it now or at the start of that item?
Later, did you say?
Yeah. Okay.
So that would be much more meaningful.
Yeah, okay. So aside from that, I do have a couple of points. I'll take this one. First is concerning the Hornby close planning application, which this council unanimously voted to object to. I'm just wondering if you can say anything about why the council made such a weak presentation of its case at the meeting at South Gloss when it was called in by the councillor from this council. So basically, it was called in. The person who called it in, to my knowledge, didn't attend the South Gloucestershire Development Management meeting. The town clerk spoke, but just repeated the single sentence that had already been submitted by Bradley Town Council. One of the people that originally voted to object to it, that's Councillor Hopkinson, actually voted for the motion at South Gloss. So all in all, and I'm not expressing any opinion about the merits or otherwise of the planning application, it just seems a very strange sequence of events. I really wonder if council resources have been used to best effect. That's the first question. Do you wish to respond to that now, or shall I go on to my second point?
Okay. My role is to pass on comments made by our panel.
Which they already had.
I know, but it's just to reinforce it to council.
It doesn't just repeating something that's in a report in front of councillors doesn't reinforce it, I'm afraid.
Roger. Yeah, I mean, I said before, congratulate the planner, that a 1.5-line objection is just not enough. I mean, this is going to stand out as perhaps 7 or 8 pages for a small application. And the larger one's got 40, 50, 60 pages, 1.5-line.
does Councillor Ash wish to say why he didn't attend the meeting, having called it in?
I couldn't, I was busy.
I think most residents would find that disappointing. The second point is concerning waiting restrictions outside schools in Bradley Stoke. So I don't know if you remember, but a whole 2 years ago, more or less, there were three consultations from South Gloucestershire about introducing double yellow lines and school zigzag markings. This was outside Meadowbrook Primary School, near where I live. Also, Bailey's Court Primary School. Residents have been to this council previously asking for things to be done. And Holy Trinity Primary School. So three schools. Consultations January, February 2020. Now in 2022. Feedback reports were published by South Gloucestershire Council in May 2020. So again, nearly 2 years ago. And yet, to the best of my knowledge, and certainly the Meadowbrook one, none of these three schemes have actually been implemented. Which is, you know, a great disappointment. So can the district councillors investigate why these schemes haven't been implemented, because the issues that they're trying to solve are ongoing, you know, day in, day out. We have people parking, you know, dangerously outside these schools. We have the local beat team putting up selfies of them standing next to the schools and saying they're enforcing things. But actually, in reality, the police can't enforce this sort of thing because it's not their responsibility. And without the lines being there and the plates on the posts, no offences are committed. It would be the responsibility of South Gloucestershire Council to enforce any double yellow line or school zigzag waiting. So, you know, it's a very frustrating situation.
Can we brief it so that you want an answer for that?
It's a request, really, that it's the district councillors look into this, why it hasn't been implemented almost 2 years after the consultation.
Yes.
Thank you, Chair. Firstly, anything appertaining to schools, there is the school safety officers. Those safety officers, to my knowledge, have not been doing visits to schools throughout lockdown, because we've had issues in our ward where similarities, you know, occurred. Secondly, when it comes to traffic regulation orders, they can take anything up to 12 months before they're even agreed by the officers. Then you have to go through a consultation process, and then it is legally advertised by the legal section. Now, if, as you say, these were agreed, where were they agreed, and where was the original request from? Did it go through the community engagement forum?
I have no idea, I don't see the relevance in that.
Well, it is, Steve, because this is part of the process. This is where it gets discussed and then taken forward from there. And if it was a requirement at the community engagement forum, that neighbours, residents, you know, parents at the school, even the school themselves had requested lines, then, you know, it's all relevant. It's all part of the consultation process. Now, if you're saying it was agreed and they haven't put them down, then firstly, I would take this up with the education safety people, and then I would take it up with Mark King, personally.
When you say I would...
Well, if you're saying that...
Are you saying you're going to do that?
No, I'm not saying that.
Well,
it's
the purpose of this council is to request the council's assistance, not to be told that I should be doing something.
No, but you're saying, Steve, that, you know, I think I'm right saying it when you were saying just now, it was requested by you. or it was in the journal?
I don't know who requested it, but I'm pointing out that the consultation was 2 years ago.
Right.
It's been through the consultation. It's had a feedback report. The statutory notices have been published and signed.
Right.
May 2021.
So in that case, it was agreed. So it lies with the education safety section and Mark King. So I would request that this council applies to them for a response. There's nothing else we can do.
Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
Yeah, but actually we'll be able to communicate with the
Yeah, I can ask that when people come to the council and make a request like this, that when a response is received, that it is personally sent to the resident who comes to the council, and he doesn't have to kind of search through minutes to find whatever the response is. As a matter of courtesy.
That's a process, yeah. We try a lot of that. I know there are a lot of requests.
I just have a question, something we have attended tonight, to repeating something that we've talked about before, about a remembrance bench or a reflection bench that we've said about a memorial garden. There's a series out with Victor Ray's Afterlife, and they're talking about that it features a bench that someone sits on and has conversations with, and they're actually now rolling out benches to local communities as part of the scheme to reflect and remember. So I just wanted to ask if we could have that on the future agenda.
Yeah.
I'll get back to that later.
That's
different to that, because we've already got the memorial bench on the agenda.
Yeah, that's all. And the council has actually already mentioned that.
Yeah.
The previous
okay.
Any other submissions from the public?
Can I just clarify? So, because I've come to talk about 73, we're going to talk about that.
Yeah, that
on the agenda.
And that's
on the agenda.
Oh, no, but it says here I can only speak now.
No. But we will allow that. That's fine.
Yeah. The submissions from the public is anything else which is not on our agenda.
Oh, okay.
To speak in that 15-minute period. So you will have a chance to talk about the 73 as and when it comes up on the actual agenda.
And then I say,
make it clear?
Yeah, that's perfect. And I've one other kind of statement to make generally to the councillors. I read today on the Bradley Stoke Journal website that two Bradley Stoke town councillors have changed political party allegiance or joined one. I kind of urge those individuals to consider resignation and allowing the public to have a by-election to elect councillors for political parties that perhaps we would like to represent us.
So I was in the Labour Party, but now in the Green Party. There are a few reasons why I haven't resigned. One is that possibly the two parties are quite similar. Another one is that the town council is non-political, so we shouldn't have politics in the town council. And another reason is that the last time someone resigned and a by-election was called, it cost the town council something between £7,000 and £8,000. And I didn't want to waste the town council that money. We are also unpaid, so it would have been just £8,000 spent by the taxpayer. So that's one of the reasons.
Yeah, but democracy isn't free though, is it? So.
Yeah, but the last time
that's
when...
The remaining term for this council is only until May next year. So a local election will be held May next year.
Thank you.
And then we've got the by-election coming due to the sadly passing of our mayor, so yes, it will be on coming.
The £15,000 we spent on by-elections last year, it was called in. That's the reason why we haven't done. Otherwise, we'd be conscious. This again, this time, there'll be called in again, election. So it will be costing only £8,000 to £10,000. So that's a cost that's like benefits or any other services which we pay. It's our taxpayers' money which we pay. So that's the reason why we are saying it's a community level.
Just one point on that current by-election that I should come up. Although it's not sacrosanct, generally the party member of the town council passes away, it's generally that same party appoints somebody else from that particular party. And I find it a little disappointing that we are having to spend between £8,000 and £10,000 on having a by-election something passed away.
Yeah.
Right. All I'd like to say about it.
Thank you. Thanks for the submission from the public. Your lights go on. So right now, after the other floor, we're receiving apologies from accidents. Anybody wants to? Not already mentioned. Then announcements by the chair. We already went our tributes to our late mayor. So that's thank you, Tony, for doing that. That's very kind. So that's one part which I know. And we'll be happy with the parents. And of course with his family. Because he was mayor of a borough house and he served as in this town. And he was before that, in 1974, he was a councillor in the London borough. So it's you can see the years of experience. I'm just reflecting. Okay, we will go to number 8 now to confirm the minutes of the meeting held on 17th November 2021. Anybody have read?
There is. So on page 12,
by the time I'm signing, there will be a lot of pages. I'm calling in, I'm putting the proposal, the ring they have in the ID number.
15.3.
We're holding that. The second page, the second, yes, the second.
councillors, yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, no problem. Can we spend a bit here? Well, thank you, councillors, for having me this evening. My name is Chris Hanson. I'm the operations director for First Bus in the West of England, which sounds further than it is, but just to fully clarify, we cover Bristol, Bath, Western Supermare, and Wales, and everything in between. But I started as a bus driver. The very first route I ever drove in service in 2008 was a 73. So I do know of the issue to which we're here to talk about tonight. Oh, thank you. So, well, firstly, thank you for having us, and I think this is a first, because this is the first time since 2019 that I've actually stood in front of people and talked to them rather than doing it on Zoom, so I'm very grateful for that, because it's always easier. However, it's not an easy subject that we're here to talk about, which is the 73. The 73, and no, I'm not the first representative from First to come and talk to you, and just to introduce my colleague, by the way, this is Matt Bryan. Matt is the operations manager for Lawrence Hill Depot, which operates the 73, so I might throw to Matt if there's some specific issues about service patterns and whatnot that raise them up, but that's just to introduce Matt. So, in essence, we've had one hell of a couple of years, much like the whole world has, of course. Good news from the government today, though, that the working from home agreement seems to be on the way out. Certainly good news from our recovery, but our recovery from COVID has been challenging. And we've been very lucky, as most other bus businesses have been, to have been supported by government funding of various sources. That's changed and flexed, as the same as the rules have, over the last, feels like a lifetime, but it's actually since March of 2020. However, that funding comes to an end very, very shortly. And our recovery currently, our current level of funding assumes, rightly or wrongly, from the Department of Transport, and it's not for me to comment as to whether that's right or wrong, that we would be at an 85% patronage level of what we had pre-COVID. Unfortunately, we are not. So in Bristol currently, our current patronage versus pre-COVID, when I say pre-COVID, we actually go back to 2019, but at the same week within 2019, which actually bizarrely would now be 2020, I suppose. So that would be January 2020 before the pandemic was a problem. And we're at 64% of our pre-COVID patronage levels. Our funding dictates that we run currently 90% of the mileage that we were running pre-COVID, across the whole of the West of England, that is, not just in Bristol, which we are doing. We're running about 93% of the service that we would have been running pre-COVID, and most of the places where it's not, unfortunately 73 is one of them, but there are some areas such as university services where things have dipped up and down a bit since then. But the reality is that leaves us with a gap, and that gap was intended to be funded, if you like, by lots of work that the National Bus Strategy has delivered, which you've probably read, and if you haven't and have a bored couple of hours, it is worth giving it a read. We've worked very closely with the Transport Authority, who have the responsibility for transport for this area, which is the West of England Combined Authority now. Obviously that changed a year ago. It used to be South Gloucestershire. And we worked with them. They put together a bidding document for the government called the Bus Service Improvement Partnership, which is also available to read, should you want to, with a supporting letter from our Managing Director. Unfortunately, there has been no confirmation of any funding whatsoever that will come after April of this year, which leaves us with a problem because we're operating 93% of the stuff we were prior to COVID, and we're only receiving 60% of the revenue. Now, we know that that will build up slightly between now and the next few months, but we have had to have a very, very critical look at some of those services that were, even before COVID, not delivering the kind of numbers that they needed to sustain a bus service. So we're not talking about making profit here, we're talking about actually taking enough money on the bus or on the app or however people pay to actually continue to run them at the level they were before. The 73, I'm afraid, is one of them. There's lots of reasons for that, and we know lots and lots of issues around the fact that the M1 and the T1, which, as you know, come right through the middle of Bradley Stoke, has taken quite a bit of the 73's patronage over the years. When I used to live in Bradley Stoke, in fact just opposite here, I used to get the 73 and lose the will to live by the time we got halfway down Filton Avenue, so I would, if I lived here still, I would be very grateful for the M1 and T1, and lots of people are.
But what that means is that we've got a challenge with the 73. And the other challenge that we've got is that it is appallingly unreliable. So any of you that use the 73, I wish to start, if I might, by apologising for the fact that that service is operating below the standard that we would expect it to be operating. It is only operating at about 63% on time, and we are requiring it, for lots of reasons, to be at 95% of where it should be. So we've got a bit of a gap, but lots of a gap, which is going to be corrected. But we have had to look really carefully at how to do that without just simply adding cost to a route that is already not sustaining itself financially. And the only way that we were able to do that without receiving funding is to look at the route in which the 73 takes and look at the patronage very carefully to see where people were getting on and off. And it became very clear, I actually went out and drove it to start this exercise, and I drove it a few times at various different times of the day. And then we looked at the data, and what the data and my observations and the driver's observations have suggested very clearly was that the stretch between the Willowbrook Centre and Orpheus Avenue was exceptionally poorly used by less than 0.09% of the total patronage on the 73 existed in that area. That's a rough number I can give you and send you, Sharon, the specific number for it. But the reality is that it represents, should we say, less than 1% of the total patronage on the 73, yet takes up a disproportionate amount of time to be able to do it. So we looked again at what we do and looked back as to the old routes that we've operated, and we all know that the route that we have now registered to operate, which we registered to WECA 70 days prior to it coming in on the 30th of January, and then discussed it with them and sent it to the Traffic Commissioner 42 days before it has to come in. And the new route, as will be on the 30th of January, is that it will return to the classic, probably the wrong word, but the old 73 route. So when it comes to Orpheus Avenue, it will instead turn left, head straight along Brookway, up past here to the roundabout, and then do the dog leg, as it's called, which is the wrong word really, into the Willowbrook Centre, with the addition of stopping at the Metro bus stop, which is the first time we've been allowed to stop the 73 there, which is really positive, because if people want to be able to interchange on to the M1 or the T1, they can. Back through the Willowbrook Centre, and then onwards, as its current route is, towards Prince Causeway. I appreciate that for some people that's probably really good news, because we know that in the past we have received lots of correspondence, and I know James Freeman came to talk to, I believe, this very council on that exact issue some time ago. However, for some people that do rely on the 73 in the areas to which it is no longer going to serve, I appreciate that this is not the news that they will be looking for. And although there is the interchange option at Bradley Stoke to Willowbrook Centre, so that you can get off the M1 or T1 and get onto that, that's not always an easy solution for everybody. So that's the change that we're proposing to make and why we're proposing to make it. I think the other only thing left to say before I take the questions is just to reassure you that that does not mean that that's the end and we're never going to consider doing anything different in the 73. These things are fluid, and we report and work regularly with the West of England Combined Authority. So as well as making the representations to me tonight, it's always worth making those representations to them as well, because they are the ones that have the ability to distribute whatever funding they have been made available by the government to be able to fund various bits. So it's just worth saying that, and we have a very good working relationship with them. Some good news on that front, if I might, which is that we're actually looking at the T1 and the T2, both of which I'm afraid fall into the same category as the 73. And the T2 is planned to be, but not confirmed yet, to be withdrawn from the April service change. It's not January, it'll be the next one. So it's not registered yet, so it's all still a bit unconfirmed. But the T1 will be increased to every 20 minutes as a compensation. And West of England will be, West of England by the authority are funding that. So they funded a frequency increase that will come in. We wanted to put it in January. The reason we didn't is because I didn't have enough drivers to ride it, because of our current national bus driver shortages that we're going through, which I can talk to anybody who wants to talk to about separately. I won't bore the full amount of you to that. But that's why.
And also for the the regularity of the tea run, certainly on a late evening, seems to be a bit rather infrequent. There's quite a few that got cancelled.
So we have had problems with reliability on T1 and all the other bus services because, unfortunately, much like lots of other bus companies in the country, we are really, really struggling to recruit staff and retain them. So unfortunately, where for good reason, there was funding put into the lorry industry, their rates of pay shot significantly above that we pay the bus driving staff, and lots of them left, not helped by a letter from the DVLA, it was sent to all bus drivers encouraging them to do so. And that was really not useful. But that, I apologise for that, because that's not right. On an evening, we try to balance it carefully, because although the M1 isn't operated by us, it is operated under contract for us, so it is our service too. And we try to balance it, but I'm sorry about your experience.
The T1s anyway, on a late night service, but more often than not, the T1s seem to get cancelled first.
Well, we're in a much better place now, so I'm hoping if you try it again, it won't be the same. But apologies.
Thank you, Chair. Chris, thank you for your explanation on this. It is an issue which, personally, I've had many dealings with James in the past, and issues over cutting bus services within Bradley Stoke, Stoke Gifford, and this area. Now, I shouldn't have to explain, but this council here is a town council, a town. Not a rural backwater, it's a town. And the actual figure now, correct me if I'm wrong, councillors, what's the population here? 20? It's more like 26, 27,000 people. And the council's age here now is what, nearly 30 years? So it's nothing new. This council has got bigger and bigger. Now also, we have an ageing population. Many of those ageing population still have to go to work, still have to go to hospitals, still have to maintain their mobility by your bus service. Now, bus services should be for the good of all, not just the minority, not just the postcode of Bradley Stoke, to the detriment of people that cannot walk. We might think it's a short distance to get to the T1 or whatever, but for those people, some of them are on Zimmer frames. They could be dead by the time they get to that T1. You know, they have to get around. They are entitled to public transport. What's in the word, public transport? Where is it? It's being cut. Now, those same people have been prepared to have sympathy with the bus company, as we all have. You've been in lockdown. You've had drivers that haven't been able to drive the buses. Just like the public have been told to work from home and don't travel. So those buses, it's obvious they're not going to have buns on seats. So what's changed? You know, I mean, I've said it before and I'll say it again. In the old days, you know, you had Reg Barney and the buses, didn't you? Bring back Blakey. Put him on any bus route. He could get on. The first thing he'd do is do a head count. Then he would look at the buns on seats. Then that would denote how much money has gone into your tills. And that would tell you whether that bus is an unviable bus service. But we have been in COVID. How can you penalise the people at Bradley Stoke for not using that bus?
I think if I might, I might answer. The issue that we've got really there is that there is the drop-off of funding. And that is what has caused the problem. You know, we are, although I agree with you that public transport is there for the public, we are a private company that has to sustain itself. And without funding, if we didn't make the change to the 73, then the 73 would simply have to not operate. Now, I don't disagree with your point, and I really do have sympathy for those that do struggle to walk. And I can see that if you live that bit further away, particularly if you live in the middle of, say, Bailey's Court Road, I can see that is a reasonable distance. And those are the points that I'm afraid are the ones that would have to go to the Transport Authority, with whom it is the responsibility to provide the transport. And I hate that that answer makes it sound like we don't care, because we don't. But we also have to be able to afford to pay the drivers and pay for the fuel, which is increasing at a rapid rate beyond anything that we could have imagined. Our pay talks with the drivers, for example, we know that we're going to have to put that cost up massively to be able to retain staff. And I have absolute sympathy with WECA, with whatever solution they come up with, but it has to be led by them. And I'm sorry that that answer is not as I'd like it to be, but that's the sad situation that we find ourselves in.
Well, as councillors, we were not told. This council wasn't told. The Bradley Stoke Journal, I'm sure you weren't aware. And, you know, this message was going to the people of Bradley Stoke. It's going down in a lead balloon. But I tell you, those people are entitled to public transport, and they are seeing their services demised again. Now, you know, if we're ever going to get people out of cars and onto public transport, this is not the way to go about it. Keep public transport where it should be for the good of all. And I accept that you've got a commercial service to run, but there is public services that have to run. And without those services, the public cannot get to their hospital appointments, their medical centre appointments, even to get to the local shops. You know, and they cannot be expected to walk, and I'll tell you, James Freeman said this to me, the people of Little Stoke can get from the Kingsway by a short walk to the leisure centre in Bradley Stoke to catch the metro bus. That is not a short walk, by any stretch of the imagination. For a mum with maybe one or two kids, kids in a buggy, an elderly person, as I said, some people on a Zimmer frame, some people in a wheelchair, some people just wanting to get to work. It's not, you know, anything out of the ordinary. They have to do their daily work. They have to get to where they're wanting to go. And
I
it's
do
not
agree
the
with
way
you.
To encourage.
I would suggest that perhaps you might want to pose the question to WECA, because actually,
oh well, yeah,
people.
Well,
and I'm not. I know that sounds
Dan
more than I intended. I do see your point, and we'll work with them and you guys in whatever is the best solution, but we can't continue to make a loss on the 73.
Well, we've got a Labour councillor here tonight. Perhaps you'd like to take that up with Dan Morris, can you?
Yes, well, another thing. My solution right now, we are talking about, if there is a clean entry, it might be successful, and if there is a solution for reintroducing the applications that we have 73, that is many people are looking for that, and that's what one thing. But right now, if that's changes in the situation. That, because in the T1, that's one which we actually, for a little bit of some of those council, I think it takes two members that I possibly took it out so that we pass to Paris to many people, which is we are very grateful that that's the service. So I would like to really have that flexibility from your part as well.
Absolutely. Okay. You have it.
Any other questions for the councillors? Yes, Richard.
Can I just read something on behalf of someone sent me? Just so you could, I can give feedback. My daughter uses the 73 bus to get to her life skills college. Due to her disability, she required travel training for months to be confident and comfortable using the service. Now, what does she do? What do the others who rely on this service do? It's a disgrace. I hope you can have an impact on changing that. Is that loud enough? So, just I suppose in regards to about the travel training, what can she do now?
I'd have to know a little more information about where she is, obviously.
Yes.
But I think that's one of the things. Those are the people that we need to hear the voice of as part of the discussions we have with WECA about how we resolve the problem.
And is there a way of this being reversible, about saying use us or lose us and going back and trying to up?
I think our financial situation at the moment is precarious to the point that we aren't able to keep funding the 73 as was. That doesn't mean, however, that it can't go back. So if, for example, the 73 and the M1 and the T1 all recover to a much better level, and you know the news from the government today and what looks like it might, then things could change. So nothing absolutely is clear, and I'm happy to come back in the summer and report on the progress and maybe bring someone along from WECA as well so that we can have a more full conversation if I'm invited to do so. But
Thanks for coming. Are there a few questions? Is that finished?
Well, I've got a lot, so if I can just collate them
but, you know,
email, I won't.
And if you get this sent to us, we'll be happy to respond.
Also, would there be that possibly so that we have much more meaningful
Yes.
Yes.
Can I just ask a question? Would it not be possible to postpone it until
you
know what the status
afraid financially no, without any kind of funding, but we have to get that change in now so that I can meaningfully have a discussion with the drivers and deal with the fact that the fuel is going up by so much. So I wish I could say yes, but unfortunately no, that change will happen on the 13th of January.
So,
yeah, thank you. Yeah, just to say, I'm from the Bradley Stoke Journal, and we have covered this on our website. So, first of all, might be a bit nerdy, but I'd just like to ask about the consultation process. So, I think you said you started this by talking to WECA. When exactly was that?
So, we have to notify them of changes 70 days prior to the registration date, which is the 30th of January. So count backwards from there, I don't have the date in my head, sorry. But we have been discussing it with them for some time. I think the reason that we weren't able to share it earlier, which we would like to do normally, is because of the lack of clarity over the funding situation with the government that was at the time. While it may be clarified now, obviously 70 days back would take us to, that was in November, so that's when we would have started the discussions about the 73.
So this
was given to WECA at the time?
Yes, and we discussed it with the public transport team within the West of England Authority and South Gloucestershire Council.
Yeah, but these statutory timescales are not just timescales for having a general chit-chat. They're timescales for specific proposals, aren't they?
So we provide proposals to the authority based on what our finances can sustain.
Are you saying in mid-November this exact proposal about the route change for the 73 was placed on the table this is what we want to do?
No,
because
so
that's
it was modified.
What the consultation period is, you say what you want to do, and then it should be discussed by the local transport authority. 28 days, is it?
That's right.
Yeah.
And then it goes off to the traffic commissioner.
And then it should go to the trans traffic commission.
So
just
we gave
the
it
way
to
you
WECA
expressed
WECA
it sounded a bit wishy-washy, that you were in some just general discussion with WECA and not about specific changes.
No, it was about specifically around the 73. Our original proposal was different, and it was actually more significant. And we modified it as a result of the slightly changed funding situation. So there was an additional change that's not relevant for here, but this is better than what we were originally having to propose.
And then it should have gone to the traffic commissioner.
Yeah.
And it should have been published in the notices of proceedings or as a document. Now I get those documents by email, and as far as I've checked, and I may not have been totally thorough, but I haven't found it in any of those notices.
But that would be a question for the DVSA, I'm afraid. I don't know. The registration process went through as normal, so there's no reason it shouldn't have been in there. So,
I don't think it has. So,
I wouldn't know, I'm afraid. We've had the stuff back from the traffic commissioner, so it's all been registered as it should have been. So I wouldn't know why they haven't put that in there yet.
Because
they are on occasion quite delayed, so that would be something for. It's not
well,
really for me to comment
today. No answer. But obviously it's potentially a problem if it wasn't advertised as legally required. So going back to the consultation, I've spoken to the town clerk, and it seems the date when you contacted the town council about the change was the 4th of January. Is that correct?
Yes.
So that's, 3 weeks before it's actually going to happen. And by that time, it's already been submitted to the traffic commissioner. That doesn't sound like the best way of working, if you don't mind my saying.
No, and I think it's a fair challenge. I think we were rather hoping that the funding situation may develop so that we could cancel it, which we can do that at the last minute. That didn't happen. So unfortunately, that's the case that caused us to, but I would like to apologise for that, if I might. I know you've worked with James before. James was my boss for a long time, and it's not how we like to operate. So I apologise. You aren't the only people that we didn't talk to, and you're the first of four groups that I'm afraid I'm going to have to make this apology to. But nonetheless, I can assure you that now the registration process is back to normal, that we can start to work forward and have a bit more clarity as to what's coming in the next few months. That's why I could talk to you about what's happening in April, for example, now, which I wouldn't have known anywhere near that far in advance for this. So I apologise to all of you and to yourselves for that.
Thank you for those responses. A couple of questions or points for councillors. You may remember that in June 2018, that's 6 months before the Metro got started, I came to the meeting and I said, look, it's likely that 73 isn't going to be viable as it is once the Metro bus starts. You know, what are your thoughts about what's likely to happen then? And I think as a result of that, you got James Freeman in to talk about things, and there was an informal consultation by James Freeman, and he reported that there was an overwhelming majority to keep the 73 route as it was at the time. But the point I want to make is, I think it was pretty obvious that something like this was going to happen, and the council was made aware of it. So there's plenty of time for the council to have some sort of contingency planning in there. So, you know, what is the council going to do now? And I can put some ideas on the table. How are you going to support the customers, the residents, on that part of the route that is now being cut out? Have you given any thought to any possible other support you can give, such as signposting them to community transport, arranging taxi services, this sort of thing? Have councils given any support to this? Have they done some sort of survey in the 2.5 years that have passed? So I'd be interested to hear about the council's ideas. Thank you.
This is long back, of age when I am under survey. I think I passed that information through. It was really transferred from here to South Bay Hospital, Parkway Station, that kind of things. Anyway, so long these things have been proven. But right now, this new development that we have to see, we definitely will be in the support of the community transfer. And I will also highlight it as a member of the community transfer network for the rest of the conversation. The taxis, I don't know whether we have. Otherwise, the South Coast Council. Is there any other councillors who want to add on to it? They can. Yes.
Tom, there is one other point I'd like to raise here with this. You're bringing these cuts in services January, end of January, the winter, the bad weather. And on top of that, there's a report just come through here this afternoon that the other bus companies, Stagecoach included, are facing industrial action, overpaying. So yet again, is this going to mean more problems for bus users? At a time of the year when they need their public transport most of all, and at a time when we're still not out of COVID, they may still have to be working from home, and you're trying to run a bus service, they're trying to live their lives, and they would willingly get on your buses tomorrow if they could. But this is the bad time of the year. You're putting cuts in their way, strikes, and God knows what. This is the other bus company.
I was going to say, just for clarity, it wouldn't be appropriate for me to comment on why Stagecoach went to industrial action. But I can say, categorically, that I know why. And it's because this pay issue is exactly the same as the one that we have. Now, we are nowhere near industrial action with our staff because we are working really closely with our trade union. But if we don't get our finances right, we will not be able to pay them what the wage they are asking for.
But then that applies, Chris, to everybody in every walk of life.
I agree entirely.
A person trying to run a home and bring a family up They are all facing increased electric bills, gas bills, everything else, and God knows what's going to come around the corner next. But they are just trying to live their lives and get to work. You're there to provide the service to enable them to get to work, to enable them to get to hospitals, to enable them to get to schools and everywhere else. And this is stopping. And I'll tell you, if you keep doing this, then the public will withdraw from the usage of your bus services. Every time you do something like this, there's another 5, 6, 10 people that will just think, oh, let's car share. Let's do something our own way. We don't need to rely on the buses. And then that issue.
That's certainly fine, Michael. Let's step on because we need to have a bigger job done. Richard, you want to say something?
Yeah, hello. I wonder if I could just clarify a couple of points that you've made. How does leaving out the herbs loop increase from your 63% of reliability to 90%? Because I don't think it has many traffic jams in that loop. And my second question is, what percentage of pre-COVID patronage would you have had to have got to have not to have done the cut to your currently 64%? And my third question is, whilst you talk about going back to the classic 73 route, it's the classic 73 day route, did you consider going 73A and B again, like we used to have?
So if I answer the first question, so what we had to do was add another vehicle to the cycle to be able to provide much more running time. So A to B, if you call A Cribbs Causeway and B Temple Main Station, we needed to add, I can't remember the exact number of minutes, but however many minutes it was, I think some jetties have got 16, 17 more minutes, so that they can actually do it within the ability of where the road network is. And to do that on the old timetable, on the old route, would have meant another vehicle going into the cycle at a cost of around, it's an approximate number, £225,000 per vehicle to go into the cycle. That's an average running cost of vehicle. Yeah, there or thereabouts. And it varies by service, so that's a generic figure. But to add that to the existing service didn't work. However, of course, we don't use the full vehicles requirement the whole time. So we needed to chop out of the service to stop having to add that vehicle or stop the cost draining of that around about 8 minutes. And that is almost the exact time it took to do that versus doing Brookway. So that's how the economics work on it. It's not specific absolute numbers because that's what our number crunches to do, but that's hopefully that clarifies it a little.
And then the patronage?
Patronage, there or thereabouts, 85% it would have needed to be to have sustained itself to have another £220,000 worth of costs put into it, which was 20-odd% below what it needed to be. So unfortunately it doesn't add up. And the third question... Yeah, 85%.
I suppose you've answered my third question by saying that you need to save the time on the route, haven't you? So if you go,
unfortunately,
yeah. That's. But one of the things which I would mention is the flexibility for retransfer, or like all the regions, to retransfer them so that will not be neglected. But there will be a lot of demand from people like that. But yeah, I know that some of these are people who go to M1 and T1, but they don't.
Okay.
Because we requested for extension from early April 1st towards the Western City Centre. So I requested first to exit the different things, which you've done. That was years ago. That was in 2000.
It's a few years ago.
Yeah.
It's quite well used.
Yeah, so that's one of the devices which we're always coming back. I hope, gentlemen, you want any questions?
Thank you for those. Thank you for answering those.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. That's really
no problem. And we would be happy to come again and continue to update you if we're invited, and Sharon's got my contact details, so we're happy to do that. And thank you for your time this evening.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Right now,
we're
recently connected to the people. They have the informers, which is also for the school, just an eligibility of
But it's our service, and we should have told you, I'm sorry, just to finish.
Thank you,
Chris.
Thank you for coming. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Okay, I'll. very tempted by that. The only hope to that I think that James is charisma.
Oh, that's a few faces.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you for suggestions. You know, to your whole time for work. We will explain, but we don't have any money for taxes. Definitely, we will start the service. Okay, let's move on. Agenda number 9, to deal with matters arising from the minutes of the meeting. If you are actually doing, I just want to do not, because we have been awarded the gold status. Have you heard that?
Sorry,
see. I'm still being awarded the Rocket House Gold Scheme for gold. So that's that. If you're actually doing, just want to pass on that information.
Okay. Yep. Good. Thank you.
All right. And I will come back 9.4. That's a 2021 BST system. Baseline, sometimes all of these rubbish and all these things are there. We want to make it to the family area if possible, so that so I think it's a propensity amount or something. Start the project, and because we'll need some money, so we need to explore that. We need to understand how much budget will come through. We will not give it, go ahead right now, we want to explore it. So we want to explore that, how much the cost is. Yeah, starting that. Next year's budget, a propensity amount is required to start. So that was your concern. Sorry, because I can see. So that's one thing. So if we explore how much it costs.
the inspector, public consultation was brilliant, and don't have any issues at all. I just wondered, we did at the time mention about having those updated on the existing differences.
Yeah,
and
I think you looked at that further down, as we highlighted, and
I was quiet until the general said, I missed it.
On this question of the dog, which I think, I mean, we had this instruction some time ago, you actually can have the dog with the dog.
Yes,
I don't think, yeah.
It's just what I said, Sharon, I'm waiting now. I'm waiting to get the ball rolling. Obviously, we're in 2022, so if we can just do those, we're able to do that, and then we can start with the plans and celebrations. And like you said earlier as well, if there's a way of including more to the celebration as well.
We need to handle that. But this one, which I think we can actually put back in the national unit so that they can actually have a working group so that they can actually start work on it.
Who's on this anniversary?
Well, that's what we just decided.
Sorry.
It's going forward.
Yeah.
So, just, yeah, if you want it or not.
that we have to look for the budget, that's why the cost of it is not the evidence how much we have to spend directly. We'll get somebody that's coming up for the task, because we don't know the outcome request from the council, the Queen's Jubilee, and let's see what that is going to come up with that for the festival. Yes, Ben.
Is that something that could be put inside the
I would have to guess that the new restriction is more community with some councils on it, but actually involving the community. We're not thinking not specific council committee,
yeah.
But a committee with some councillors and
yeah.
Non councillors.
Yeah, and spread the load, because there's lots of pockets of things going on that people could take ownership of and get involved, so it's not just on us.
So it's a working group. I think it would be better to refer it to it as a working group, because then you can have people who aren't councillors on there, and it's much more informal.
Absolutely.
We're just going back to cycle line. It would be worth seeing a cycling group. Because they have a list of kind of like 30k cycle rides that they've already done for various different groups and used to keep them with the training association and things like that. So they've already got them. So rather than the work that somebody else has already done, speak to them and give them a contact.
Well, I'm the representative of the twinning, so I've been speaking to them about the twinning things, but also they are friends about cycling. Yes. Oh, that's good. So that could all
going to be made for the center. do most of the benches, and actually, if you look at the picture for the ones that Charles and I have leisure, they are the daily local benches.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
And they just add a bit on for getting it through there, so ones are cheaper.
And another children of your collection.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd be going to use daily local.
I'll look into it. But also, are these, so we're buying these benches and they're going at.
One's going at Bailey's,
yes.
In the new play area.
Yeah.
When that's done, that's the NHS bench. But the other one, there's no firm decision where that's going. Possibly, because the suggestion was that you go into Brookway,
yeah.
And
yeah.
In where the trees are. To set up
that
memorial garden there.
Yeah, that would. But, so would we order the bench before kind of making a plan on how to rejuvenate it?
I think we probably will to get it whilst the
steel
prices go up again.
So
we can just put it
in
storage,
yeah.
So that's not
good.
Yes.
Will we not think we'll put the micros?
That's
what
we're
going to do.
We're
going to
take the
old
one out, put the
memorial
on
it.
Yes.
That's
what
we
want
to do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
what
we
want
to
do.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Find out an important thing which we've been talking about for a long, long time. 9.5. And I'd like to try to stand in order. 5.5
So Ian.
Yeah, so you have this part regarding the change of wording that's from staffing to staffing and job office connected to staffing that's one. And also bringing the so I just wanted to bring that also. So that part.
So, yeah, so at November 4th Council, it was proposed and seconded and then stands in abeyance until tonight. That standing order 42.5, the amendment to the staffing committee will be a special standing committee comprising the chair, the vice chair of the council, and the chairs of the other standing committees. So that was proposed by Councillor John Ash and seconded by Councillor Rector as well.
Oh, you've already voted on it.
Well, no, because you propose and second, but then you don't make a decision until this meeting. So, yeah.
Yeah.
an option of terms of reference of the ministers and staff committee. Last we have terms of reference, but we have some amendments. So as you could see, the last part you could see that terms of reference and the time we mentioned. So with some of the changes, we could actually do with that, because I feel the one that we are facing, it's town council working, the line of its own. There's a council that's quite other than making it more bureaucratic, so let's just make it more accountable for the staffing. We can actually have advisors doing it, but advisors are not the one who's working at the committee. Yeah, so what are the changes that we have? We haven't had any discussion about it, but last time, Ben, we was for some of the changes we would like to do.
This is only part. This is only like the.
But otherwise, well, I'll like to. The terms of references, which I mentioned, anyway, the other part is actually completely irrelevant right now. The first part of that. If you look into that, talk about this because it's a change in purpose. It's a finite knowledge out purpose, it's just for staff. So it's the overseeing staffing matters of the council. That should be the thing of the council, and all the performance of staff delegating. You will see reports of the town about the residents, that's fine. Number three, European, that's fine. Number four, onwards, I don't think we can really do that. 14 onwards. So that's fine.
Can you take out the reference to the green book?
Yes, yeah, you can take out the reference to the green book. That's fine. Yeah, 22 is actually be there.
Okay.
Yes, yeah. So that's our purpose, yeah. So with that amendment, I would like to question. Yeah.
So, what the HR advice to come up with, is that supervisor power of our terms of reference? No, no, no. So on in this book, what have we got?
Yeah.
We've got the covering email with the recommendations of what's going on. And then inside that, you've got a simplified draft terms of reference to staff, which gives a very simple responsibility to manage community, confidentiality, delegate powers, and the community role. So what you all just proposed in there was you're still going with the initial terms of reference. However, you've striped off the list some of the outline areas of responsibility. But I have to say, if you review the personally, I think the draft of the reference, which are smaller, in conjunction with what you've kind of just done, is actually a tidier way of representing what the...
It will make it more bureaucratic.
How is that more bureaucratic?
Yeah,
you're saying use 1 to 5 this, and then for number 6, committee will, and add the term of reference that will be drafted on the
No, because then we are tied that there should be an advisor to advise. Because start a committee, get a point, because otherwise we'll be left. We have to pay. It's a key lot of free things would say we are hired for doing that. So Tony, if you want to talk about that, yes.
I think what Tom is trying to say, if we're hired by HR, if you totally contact HR, there's a cost. And this year's a date, we spent over £1,000 on making a stamp on it. This year, although it's not one time has anybody within the staffing material, the two chairs, three chairs and both.
That's not a lot of right now.
When I was on staff committee a long time ago, when it was my colleague there as chair of the finance body at the time, we had issues that came through, and we saw that finance and at the time we drew a vision that £80 million budget would not work. HR guidance advice we needed, because we did have instances where we were kind of running a bit blind, where we didn't understand how we could apply policy to individual cases that are being brought forward. So we used it as an external consultation case, which did go through council probably 6 or 7 years ago now. I can't remember the exact date, but it did go through, and we managed to recommission that budget specifically to give us that guidance and advice that
let's right now talk this one. Right now, my proposal is right now to take into measure. The proposal is to staffing references, you know, the risk of some references you see from membership, meetings, confidentiality, delegated powers. But the delegated powers are also for external process, but that's for the committee. That's right. Okay, from the next six onwards, that's a bunch of references, is 1 to 13 and 22. That's the simplified version. So that's only for staffing. So right now we have the terms of references, which are assigned. All in favor for this proposal, please show that the terms of references single motion. Code application, time.
Yeah, so if I just read this out, yeah. And I will put it in a minute. So we're pleased to announce we've been informed we've achieved quality bond status in the local council scheme. It really is significant because I think we are only the second, I think the only other one in Alga, many hours of work to get the website sorted and the documents sorted and everything. And highlight the very best that we as a sector can achieve for our communities. And in addition to this, the accreditation panel actually stated that they were very pleased with the overall quality of the application and were particularly impressed with the council's website and newsletter. So I know that there is a feeling that it's a waste of time, but I think it really does demonstrate that we are a good council, that people do come to us for advice and guidance. And
yes, definitely. Yes, definitely. Yes. And with that, okay, I also want to wish last part of the question. I would like to have a picture. It's not one person, it's a team. And it's actually this council staff and councillors. So rather than just sort of doing the picture, I would like to have a picture of our council together, a group picture. Okay. So when will it be a convenient time, a daytime, so all of us to group together?
Staff day,
it needs
to be some
point
during the day.
Yeah, staff day, otherwise we can combine the pictures, you know, but the thing is, if you want councillors and like existing, we need one of the things if we can, so you should all be there, that's the thing. That's
what body gave the award? It's the National Association of Councils, so it's a national award across the whole of the country. So there's three levels, there's foundation, there's quality, and then there's quality gold. Last time, 4 years ago, when in 2017, we managed to get the quality status, but they changed the criteria, and they are actually much more difficult to get now. They upped their game significantly, and you have to provide a lot more information. And
how long have you been there?
Sorry? That lasts 4 years.
So 2017 was right now the right time we got the gold status. One of the things, our science program example, 2008,
oh,
I don't know, for some reason.
For
some reason I was elected to the county accreditation panel, which has to check. But then I used to think, why we are not doing it, why we are not doing it. But and right now we achieved it. And also I'm very pleased to hear from the awarding body. Because of our newsletters are really good and our websites are good. And I've been pursuing for that for some time. And thank you. And thank you, everyone. So that's the reason. Also, documentation part, you know, the minutes and things, it's much more simpler. It's easy to read, to understand. So thanks to you, Sharon, for doing all this work. So when will be a good time? So can we actually give out any dates, or do you have any proposals regarding the dates? So that we need when you put the person in sooner, so we cannot write a week long. You are working people, Ben, you want any suggestions?
Okay. So maybe lunchtime might be better, so we can take a break and go on. So we're now still working from home, so I'm thinking maybe lunchtime, and we can come here and take a photo.
Yeah, so when which date will be?
I'm so flexible. So.
Is it correct?
No, not yet.
No, 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 you don't need it. This is like the district for our.
We're announcing the fact that we've achieved it.
So I know that Stephen is going, that's the reason why I moved Stephen.
Yes.
Yeah.
We might actually not get the certificate for a couple of months.
Just
select
today,
if I can
make
the following.
No, tonight, please.
Your staff, right? Not only staff you can actually get, but this one.
Oh, what the staff?
You will be putting all the stuff. It's only one, two people. It'll be all the stuff.
Well, you could do your council's budget tonight,
didn't
you? Because actually, you're
a
full
council. No, Brian.
Oh, sorry, Brian. Sorry. I'll leave that one to you.
So, you and Anna are going to go the next 2 days so that they can be in the daytime so that the picture will be better, lighting, and things like that. All right. Okay. So, we will move on so that with the picture you can also say that. Okay.
So much.
That's fine. Okay, the 9.8, that's also an important thing. 9.8 update of improvement of activity centers manager / deputy town clerk. Sharon.
So, we sent out 28 application packs. We have paid the term for shortlisted to apply for interview. I'm not going to say anything about their name because we're still waiting.
he accepted it about the event, but
not officially, but we will. It didn't work in that way. I will let you put that.
We have good candidates, so even if that person is not, there was an excellent.
Yes,
one.
There is.
There
is,
yeah. It's very, very good.
And also my appreciation to town clerk for doing that administrative work as well as HR advice. So number 10, to receive minutes of the Finance Committee held on the 8th of December 2015, appointment of 10.1, appointment of councillors to carry out internal governance inspection. So that's actually two councillors to be checked all over the line. Anybody who is volunteer to actually do that? Yes, Ben is always in the program.
Can I just confirm this has to be linked in with the internal audit dates? So we've just moved into the audit to the 23rd and 24th of February, to hopefully so the internal audit is the obvious. And normally the internal governance inspection is a week or so after that, so if you look at the first or second March.
Anybody else? Anybody else?
The internal controls?
I'm happy. I think I said once if you would sit down with me and you learn the thing.
You won't
sit down.
Well, but it's a really useful exercise, same with the internal controls. So that's the like financial security that we have in place so that I can't go out and spend £100,000 or whatever.
So two things, so the contract we have.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So two.
Second one.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So two councillors want to carry out the internal government inspection. And all in favour? Then,
I'll leave out
to
set
a date. So now it's 10.2, 2021, we must conduct the
Rachel. This is just to give an update because decisions were made at finance as much as we could. One-year fixed rate bonds. One was maturing on the 24th of December. The United Trust Bank. we had 1% bonds maturing, and we decided to stay where we were and reinvest at 1.25%, which and we had that information. Cambridge and Counties. We have another one-year fixed rate bond. 0.95%. We didn't have the definite reinvestment in terms at that point, but I had a range. And after the Christmas break, we didn't have much time to actually sort of implement it. So the decision was made in finance, as I sort of spoke to the whole email, Tony. The decision was made that as soon as the information was made, the members of the Finance Committee would be allowed for their 10% to reinvest if the yield was in the ballpark of what was reported, which it was. So we've gone into another one-year fixed rate bond, again at 1.25%. So it's up from the previous investment yields, but obviously with the emerging inflation. Both Cambridge and Counties and United Trust Bank. Yes.
was very valid.
One's eight, yeah. So we just basically we just hold the money. The that was looked at, but in I think it was October, there was the investment strategy policy was set, and the maximum terms left a year because we knew that inflation was coming in and we didn't want to be tied in for a 2 year period because we're limited where we can actually go, and we also have to take into account what's. I mean, that's just the 2 year bonds we have from owners.
All right, okay, next one. Right, that's update, that's finished?
That's just an update.
Okay, well, on to receive minutes of the planning and development on the 24th, on the 22nd December. So we have, the school bus pilot project in Granite Stoke, so you can have a
update on that one?
Yeah.
So obviously we've had it as a monthly thing on the Planning and Environment Committee meeting for a very long time now, updates. And then at the Planning and Environment Committee on the 24th of November, councillors asked for the pilot project to be added to the next full council meeting, councillors to discuss and make a formal decision of the council as to whether the town council are in support or against the e-scooter scheme. So the extracts just show that for those who aren't on the planning environment, to show you what's happened so far. And then I did then receive an update from Tom Lacey at South Gloss, which he's confirmed it's a joint update from both the South Gloss Council and Wetland. So I'm assuming, hopefully, that you've read it through.
Yes. One of the main points was that there's still parking schemes outside the street doors, but not near to them, but bang outside the front door. And they've come back and said, well, we haven't had anybody yet been essentially been caught on a scooter or drinking, so therefore it can basically stay there. That's basically what they turned around and said. And I think that's what we need to change.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter whether it's what we decide is a certain property.
I think it would be useful as a town council because we did, as a committee, we did say that we were unhappy with. Yeah, we're
tend to fake the situation of keep parking. There's only one side where we've got students bang outside the entrance of the street. And all my folks have said that we've got plenty of other places to put them. We don't have to park them right outside a pub, which is tempting fate. And they're basically upset, well, we haven't had anybody been caught yet on a scooter, so therefore, you know, it's fair thing. I think that's a very good answer.
So what's the suggestion?
It's very interesting to see that a storage area in Brislington warehouse caught fire with several hundreds of scooters destroyed. They've been banned on London for transport, so you can't use them on a bus or the underground unit where I've actually taken on. Because of the fact that they have had track ones which are all the time.
Battery. Yes, sir.
So, as part of the ask was to kind of voice like opinions of anything, so we're going by loops really, the planning programs. So, somewhere at Christmas Eve, three minutes before I got to take the doctor, I was planning to run a lot of videos, so I was running around the Westwood area. And doing that fairly frequently, Fairly frequently, I would often have to negotiate scooters on paths going down to the bus stops that I was left past them, which wasn't great. You kind of jump from the place and like all the nerves were doing, like jump on the grass and then quite fast. They get all the issues with, well, I don't know if they're kids, but younger people anyway, using them. 2-3 people riding scooters. Yeah, and not alone. That you've also got on areas of like Webster Road by Bayland, by St Mary's Primary School on Main Road, there's just clusters of them get dumped on the pavement, and again you've got to manoeuvre all around these scooters. So they are a nuisance in terms of, I found a nuisance in terms of, I want to be a footpath user, I can't use a footpath or I'm having to make accommodation for using the footpath when they shouldn't be on the footpath. And they are left in very precarious and inappropriate places. So, just from my opinion, I just find it really frustrating. Forget the whole good and the green aspect on it. If I was also looking at it, I'm quite on the fence. I would want to be kind of probably also, I think, is too much of a nuisance and too much of a
hindrance. Yeah, that's true. Because one of my solutions is, I agree with. Simply a much more longer strap. I think it's able to carry in the buses. It will be user friendly for many people so that rather than using the path, they can hold the bus and drive the rest of the path with them. So it will be a much more comprehensive and holistic way of transport. So I'm for electric scooters, but they may right now be a particular argument and it's responsible.
I can take it great as the child got it's the trials happening and there's lots of feedback on these issues. But the trials is being extended and I don't know what the end game is.
Mm-hmm.
What are we supposed to do? Is someone going to come out with a really good idea that there's particular parking bays, like physical parking bays, if you left it, is there more penalty for leaving these students in inappropriate places? And no one seems to tell us those things.
Well,
I'm not looking in the right place.
They said they're going to review the target spaces as well as the target spaces. So we've taken on board the suggestions that we don't like any parkways on the front.
You're right. You said there, yeah, but it's not our policy to foot out inside the post. But you said, as far as the Three Brooks is concerned, that it's okay because we haven't had an incident yet. Basically, he's contradicting himself.
Well, maybe what I'm not going to do.
It's tempting to say that. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Generally, e-scooters are a good idea.
Yeah.
You know, they just need to obey the rules. And the problem is, as Ben rightly said, you see them with kids on them. And the only way they could have got them on there is because their parents have done their photo ID with a driving license to be able to register them.
Or someone else.
What they've got to do is what they can do is for the parking scenarios that they don't actually switch off the cost of it until they're parked in the right place.
Yeah.
And that's how they work. You know, and all they've got to do is just say, well, you just can't park it just there.
Well, how close to the pub are they?
Well, it's an entrance.
Well,
that's
a good one.
Well, literally, you walk out of the entrance. I think the problem is that the Willowbrook Centre would be a good one, but because it's private land, and I guess that would apply to the Three Brooks car park as well, it's private land, not public driveway.
Well, it can't be, it's outside the door.
Well, it is, it's literally on the pavement, so you've got
the
park that
comes
out,
and
it's sitting on the pavement there.
Well, I was just trying to try and get Frank's conclusion to get right, the normal class factor to say, they've got more than 3 that you say that you don't want to park there.
Okay, I'll go along with that. Yeah, I do propose that.
I think you need to ask as well, for like, what is the, in terms of public consultation on the trial and your success, what's their plan? What do they want to, what do they want to do with the trial? A wheelchair on the pavement, that's awful. Imagine if a wheelchair and can't use the pavement. And that's discriminatory in everything. I mean, that's just awful. But what, how are they ensuring that you're going to have a plan to take that feedback from it?
Yeah, that's what I agree. And also, one of the came to us the other day was that she was really terrified about these things come quickly. And then she was shocked, you know, she was like, and that's a big problem. So even if she's terrified, that's a
well, they were going to address that.
They did say that, they said they were going to put some sort of noise on it.
Sorry, it's a favor for that, you better.
Are we able to ask the question about the proposed one? You've mentioned meeting committee. Yes, that was to find out the age of consensus.
Plan
of it. Plan, right.
It was
the age of consensus
so
of what do people want around this table?
What's the fairness been shouted by the stone, a more sternly letter than what she previously done? And the result of this was.
No, 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 I think that's kind of what I'm aiming for. As a group, are we like for Tom's points for it? I plan to go on like on the fence for it. I really don't know what I'm saying because I get the green letters, don't get the message from all past that. But are we for it, so we want to support the trial? Or is it saying we kind of like now actually want to be more robust in responses against it? So the idea would be it's not here.
Well, it doesn't matter because it's a surplus.
No, we discussed
this
not being
a
match rate. We discussed this not being a match rate. Instead of having to continue to go through the loop of unhappiness and pleasantness about it, it's more a case of, well, at least our stats, you know, we are in favour of disabled, so we'll put up the unpleasantness of it, try to engage as best as possible in public consultation and providing feedback in a regular
interview.
It's worse than that, wouldn't it? It's nationwide.
Yeah.
So, one or two councillors have stopped
Environment. Sorry, I'll get there eventually. It's the note, no, it's following discussion, Councillor Ben Rand has proposed that East Street is quite a project to be added to the next one, perhaps one of the councils to discuss and make a decision as to whether the six town council are in support or against this East Street scheme. Seconded by Terry and a vote taken 5-8 by against the vote of Harry. So, as much as you say respond from the letter, say no, we find a letter, that's not answering the question that we propose as part of planning and driving. Are you for or against it? Or you could just take that proposal and say, actually, indifferent to that, we don't want to say that. But I was asking that proposal that has come to this council, can we provide an answer? Not write more letters, but yes, write letters back if you're responsible for proceeding.
Could you, what I suggest is, perhaps can you just vote on this specific one about the Tony proposed in terms of, and then, oh sorry, and then we can discuss,
address
the question, yeah?
Okay, so that's for regarding the first one, is regarding the letter. So
just
all
one more final letter to see that.
But what I feel that the character regarding that letter was a concern for the community regarding these kind of fears.
But you could include, if you decide that you are against it, although you understand the question, you could include that because this one is literally just linked to the parking outside the park.
It's all right, the publisher, and the other issues in the local.
Yes, all in favour. Carry on.
Decide whether for or against it first, because really, if we're going to say we're against it, there's no point in writing a letter, because to my mind, whatever letter we say, in whatever words we use, all that's going to happen is they're going to come back and say, oh, you know, all the sort of platitudes that they've already said. So to me, it doesn't seem any sense in sending any more letters if we're then also then going to say, don't agree with it continuing anyway. Because if we don't agree with it continuing, we might as well disagree. We might as well say that and then stop discussing it. Because we've got no control, like everybody's been saying, we've got no control over whether it is or isn't rolled out.
But I think the point is that if it continues, we really do want that space moved. So whether you're for or against,
so we will move on to with that discussion. The letter writing, all in favour of the letter, which is.
So this is a really strong letter.
Well, this is just
all, it's all in favour.
But this
case
is from the council rather than just a committee.
So, all in favour.
So then, point is about, yes, council's views on whether you're in favour of the scheme as a whole, taking out the public, just generally, East Winters, to give feedback to South Wales as to whether the town council are in favour of it or against it.
Okay, so this is the point which I made. I'm not completely against it. But there should be some element of action for these kind of issues that people coming in. That's the case, people without intimidation. They're walking up the footpath, and all of a sudden it's coming, and they are stopping stuff. So that kind of scenarios create some issues, then the problems. So you're saying she was shocked for some time. So that's the word she was upset, but that's it. So these are the issues that I have, yes, all along.
Sorry, I was just going to say, the problem is, just in the way that they have responded, saying that no one was found drunk on a scooter outside the Three Crooks, there's no, they can just
monitoring,
simply,
no monitoring.
Yeah,
no
exactly,
police.
They can just simply say the same thing. Each sort of negative comment, they can just say, well, we've not heard that. So it's almost saying, well, in that case,
I'm not really sure what kind of, other than getting the police to actually police it, which really then that takes costs and all of that sort of thing.
The police said, do you know what the police said? If the red car, sorry, the toy scooters, which they have to do that, so they can have the
manpower.
Yeah.
They've got a point though, haven't they? The police have
got
a point. Because these people are making money and then still expecting the policing of it to be taking place by people, by sort of services that are already being paid for by the taxpayer anyway.
That's, yes.
Oh, and at some point this year, this scheme is going to come to a halt.
For sure.
And they're going to have a final consultation. What is Dan Norris, as Mayor of Wexford, and Mark Shelter as the Chief Constable, what are they going to put this out to the people, the councillors, councillors, the public? They're all entitled to a say in this because it's something that they've had to have forced on them. There was never a consultation to begin with, it just got rolled out.
Yeah.
And the first we all knew about it was when they were on the streets.
Yeah.
Now, there's four and there's back. Yes, so at some point, they're going to have a proper consultation with everyone. The police, I know that there are police officers, there's a licensed officer who has gone out there and has caught people to arrest on these scooters three times over an even minute. And he's had to chase them, leaving clubs in the licensed premises. The taxi trade, they're absolutely up in arms about it. Because instead of people now coming out of pubs and clubs, nighttime economy, getting in a taxi, they're getting on a scooter instead. That loses them business. Besides the fact that they are having to fight them on the road, getting in the way of the traffic, abusing the highway, and they are actually breaking the law. So, there's got to be a recognition here.
Okay, add to that one.
I think that if we look at this section 6.1 that we apply from the east to this, it's basically saying you have all the excuses, not being committed to change anything. And then if we agree to the reply from South Clause, there's no report reported by the police driving out with an influence of alcohol. Well, there's no law to do that. If they got caught, there's no offence to give to the writers because currently there's a vacancy lacking the law. So, of course, maybe there's no report, but that doesn't mean it never happened.
Whoever registers the scooter and you get a card on it, they get done for that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, Roger.
So, there are rules of case point, that people come out and tell them to get drunk on it. People have been known to be drunk driving cars.
Yeah.
Yeah. There'll be other trouble with bad events.
Oh, it's not their problem, is it? It's the police control and the courts.
Well, yeah, it's a major
issue. Okay, so that's it. Ben, do you want to be able to get a
council? To me, it's like, I just wanted to know, it seems like generally in favour, but there's just issues with the implementation.
Second point is, these scooters are fixed. If it's a more flexible one, it will be better without people being able to register.
I believe there's a second generation that is addressing that. I did hear someone who they are looking to make smaller and fuller so they can have a parallel
transport.
Yes. You won't be able to do that on the transfer.
But that's it's because of the battery. Yeah. There are ways looking at it, the technology. Sometimes that will be the way forward, because if you're actually growing, this is a way to be connected to the environment, people will use it.
I don't have a lot, because I haven't ever used one.
You haven't used one?
I stood on one picture, but I didn't
show.
So
that's
a
big picture,
I'm sorry. Yeah, no, I haven't used one. I've probably used this again, I think, but I do remember just, I mean, I can only say what I have had of the feedback of seeing on Facebook or people talking to me. It was rocky in the beginning, like a good thing sometimes it is a new thing, I think goes in 100% smoothly. But since 6 months, I've not heard or seen or had emails direct from any of my utility, but it is, you know, I'm always around, and I don't think I'm good, but that's not saying. But I personally, like you're saying, would like clarity on what the end game is, what, like you're saying, what, like, when it ends, what happens then? Are they, and if they're elected to ask them, what is their process as well? We
can be a separate factor just to say what's the consultation period, not what happens during in the consultation. How does the consultation work? Who are they going to come for?
And also, you have feedback from the community regarding these issues, you know, people fail the applications. There was already, they agreed that they will put some sound to I don't know whether some of the people there, when I mentioned
and
that.
Screen.
Yeah, it's great, yeah.
It's a separate letter,
yeah,
from this particular publishing.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, it's about the publishing business of the
I agree. Yes,
we need to be at the end.
Yeah, we need to conclude this, yes.
There's
then it will become binding. The problem is, then the issue is, if you actually, and if you pass, or see the town council is in favour for that, and it will sometimes damage or most something in a way. So I feel not to go that route from this council. Because we can actually say, yeah, like just Tony mentioned, that the last 3 years until the consultation was a process going to be asking for a separate one. So that may be a better way.
But
I suggest that you could say something on the lines of, so you are generally in favour, if you are, of the idea behind it.
Yeah, not against.
Right, not against. Hang on a minute, let me just, if I just read this, we can change it. So not against
the motion or the theory.
One more thing, that our first part itself, we are not against. Number one, we have seen this regarding the implementation of the and execution of this project. That's been that way.
I
want
to say something before, we say we're undecided, but we're encouraged by the green aspects and the mobility that scooters offer.
No,
however,
we've got
to
be not against it.
haven't decided. So we're voting.
Yeah,
we haven't decided until we know. We've decided. It's either positive ramifications.
But you know, that vote is fine again. It's like, but we are not against, but we are actually have big concerns regarding the again, but we have these concerns regarding the limitation and that's as to
the suggest that we put at the expense, at the employees' expense, to make sure that they don't expect that, you know, we're suggesting that the police, actually the real police, get involved.
I guess those are really that we're going to get them until we've had the full, trial period, because we don't know exactly
Steve, bear in mind as well, Tom, I mean, you've still got the illegal and the legal security.
Yes.
And you have had a comment from the mayor in Bristol that he wants it all legal.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, how can you do it? Some of those scooters are capable of doing 82 miles an hour.
Service terminated. Because if we are to give a vote, it will be sometimes will not be good for us, you know, in the long run. So
it's a good point.
So and so leave it. And with that, can we actually forward that email, so letter? So would like to screen that. Yeah.
So that asking about the end game.
Yeah.
So that's fine. Yeah. That one
the rest of it. Yeah. So I would like to propose writing and sending another letter regarding that. Okay, all in favor for such a strong worded letter? Yes, that's also in there.
Thank you. councillors are in the current square, and I think this is how the grants were last year, so we had to wait for the discretionary list.
Yes, I think there's a decision yet to be made. At the moment, we are working around the Jubilee grant, which was applied. Obviously, our council will have a good grant, which should interest the banks. But then that will definitely be written to all council organizations who apply to the Jubilee fund. We should have decision of that as to whether town council can also apply.
Yeah, I'm not sure where we are discussing that. It's at FV18. Sorry, we're not doing it. Business rates.
Yeah.
Because we
they
were under the 55,000.
We have.
For
so much. Yeah, we got grants.
So we have that discretionary grant as well.
Yes. So I'm hoping we can get this one as well because this is linked to business grants, but we fall within a grey area.
The only thing that will be coming up, I suppose, and we are beginning to get emails on from the public, is asking us about the council tax.
Council tax, yeah.
Horses coming up.
Yeah, the council tax, yes. So there's a consultation.
And they're being told, South Bucks have told them to contact us as councillors. Not the right way about, is it? That will be decided by all the political groups within South Cross.
Roger.
Yeah, my energies have been devoted to finding and calculating the
Because one of the things that from my side is first officer, we have a press release from the council of we also done our newsletter this time. But obviously the double big press release coming out for our field status, the baby school, the area thing and the things like that. So if there are any suggestions of the woman who carried it. Like the word, so for example, but always we are actually adding that numbers.
And we've got to start doing it for maybe school.
February, we haven't done
the first
thing.
Just
choose.
I will let everybody know, I'll do nothing else.
But I request you to make sure of the getting the date so that we can actually. So that's just right. We are happy to be just to know the date so that.
They know more than I. Not as far as February.
And one more thing I just want to update. The police commissioner, there was an increase in the police precepts in the tax side. Almost £10 in a year. That's almost 89 pence for every month. For if
finish on the 20th.
They've
done that. To be honest, they haven't drafted the deed. Maybe after a few years' time, you may have to offline with the one. So,
but
right, they're not completed, but you can actually go and see that.
Yes, yeah. Oh, well, yeah. I was just wondering if there was going to be an official
question.
No, it's not us, it's
South
Cross.
We just, we can actually do Christmas, but the thing is, not us. We've been campaigning for that. We've been campaigning for a long, long time. It happened. Okay, so it's a comfort break for 5 minutes. Yes.
Last one for next month is February.
Yes.
It's LGBT History Month, and some of them are involving civil society. So if the town council is planning to do anything, there will be an email going out for those who are interested in attending four sessions in February. The day to be out first.
I'm actually for completing the meeting on time, but let me know when we actually say something.
I'd rather carry on,
so
I'm
going
to leave
early
anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Number 14, financial matters. 14.1, 2022-2023, final paper traffic. I had a discussion with Rachel regarding that one.
Thank you. Thank you.
into consumables and printed cartridges, an increase of 5,600 just based on current performance. Hygiene and disposal, that's for the dog bin out here. South Gloss confirmed a 6% increase in their contract for next year. We're coming up to the first of the cleaning contract that ends in November 22. We're going to have a big hike here, I suspect. The current provider is struggling to retain staff. He reckons he's running at a loss. He was by far the cheapest out of all of the quotes that came in when we took him on initially. So just to be on the safe side, and I hope it's going to be in that with the rate of inflation as it is at the moment, I've allowed a 25% increase just on the cleaning contract.
That's providing you've got the same contractor.
No, that's assuming we're going outside, because that's what I'm saying. He came in so low. The gap between him and the previous contract, the other contract is huge.
Well, we're looking at other people, there's loads of people.
But I think the price will go up. So if it doesn't, then we'll make an adjustment in that budget at that time. But I think it would be prudent, and especially with sort of salaries and things going up, that we need to build something in. The other thing to take into account was that the current contract was supposed to increase on the third year, and because we carried on with them sort of through the lockdown and what have you, he didn't implement that. So we're already paying under what we would anyway for a very, very cheap.
Just to bend you on.
Yes, really. So if we here we've got current budget and a new budget for the public. Instead of those budgets, contract. So if we're coming to the end of the contract and the budget that's kind of been just shown public banks is perhaps and then we sit here and set a new budget for next year, and add funds to said budget, that's on public record of being, well, councillor has proposed a XYZ in six against said budget, and then we go out for a tender process and find it. It does look a bit uneasy.
But we have to be transparent. So unfortunately, where we have to be transparent and issue everything, the information is out there. But because the budget is set, that does not mean we spend it. You see, we're building in protection. So if we don't reach it, it's just that we know that the gap between the quotes that came in when we took on the current supplier, it was massive, absolutely massive. And we've had a lot of press movement since. Do you want me to go through each one individually, or?
I think if you want to put it to the council, they've got questions on it. Otherwise, it will be all. One more question, if I may. The 5061 National Insurance, it's 34 to 35, when a year before you were saying your rating was getting 30.
We're a person down at the moment.
The current budget is 32, we've taken it down to 30, but then you said on this side the current budget is 34.
34, because we've got pay increases that come in on an annual basis.
The current budget on this side is not reducing it to 30.
Sorry?
There's a forward plan then, this is what is that?
It's reducing the current this year's to 30, because
then you say the current budget is 30.
No, that's for 2022-23 from the third budget draft.
and this is 2021-22.
Yes, they're two different financial years. The current budget in the third budget drop for 22-23 for next year is 34,000.
So we're saying on this side, you've taken it down to 30.
But it has been fucking at 34, but you're suggesting putting it up to 35.
Yes. So what I'm saying is that this is the current budget for 21-22.
Yeah. 21-22.
Yeah.
I got that. 22.
Yes.
And then if you stop on 22-23,
you're
34.
Yes.
So
we'll be talking about.
Yeah. Because that's based on the forward plan. So we've got years we've got the current year's budget, and then we've got next year's budget. And next year's budget is based on us being full staffing. Because we are a person down at the moment. It's also based on estimated uplifts following appraisals, because some staff will go up.
This is 21-22, and you've reduced in that year to 30.
Yes.
Yeah, on this side, which is 22
to 23, following
so
financial year.
You're starting now still at the end of 22.
No.
Well, is this 22-23?
Yes.
I think I know what Tony's trying to say. Because if we look on page one, so the NI contribution, so current budget, that's 32,000, that's 2021. And the new budget, the 30,000, that's 2022.
No,
so
that's 21,
that,
22, that's the same, yeah.
So what's that new budget? So that's 30,000.
Sorry?
The way
so
I interpret that is that this,
all
the remembrance on this side, the budget beginning year was 32,000.
Yes.
It's been reduced down to 30,000.
30, 30
so
for the current year.
Yeah. We then flip over to the next financial year.
Yes.
That was currently planning
that's been itemized. we roll it forward and I have to keep them separate. That's what. So unfortunately, we have got a load of those showing. But going forward, back to the report, so the precept options.
So it's a, this one is normal change. Yes, that's right now. Things like that. Second part. Run by the service for the last 16 years, that's reason. Yes, Ben.
So, my question is that absolutely nothing we've gone through in 2017 is this time being justified to increase. I think the officers, we can kind of manage it in terms of we get started. But every time we've been on the council in 10 years, every time we've sat here, every 5 years, credit to me in terms of how to provide that information and you can kind of take action where it is. But my opinion, where the focus is, and all the other increases are expecting the cost of living and everything else. So I don't see why we should do that. And if we have a shock in terms of in the next financial year, because we do start to go terrible with increases and CPI and all the other buckets and jobs, we've got a full reserve at the moment of funds, which is staying like a coffee shop, and if we work on, then into the next budget system year, we can readdress it. Because this whole coming year is very big, very uncertain thing in terms of what it ends up being like. But why do we need to come in to kind of pass on that risk to the residents when we manage ourselves in a way that we can sustain that coffee shop?
You're
right.
As John, I will not come to John.
But I don't agree with them on that, and also we have got to be responsible for the taxpayer. And I know it's only 58 pence a year, whatever you want to say, but that's not the point. And it, gas is going up, fuel, everything's going up. And we are a very, very well run town council, both from the councillors and from the staff. And I think we'll be doing a discredit to the people of Bradley Stoke. up. I think next year probably as well. And if cuts have got to be made, then let's make cuts, let's not just let's not do what Felton did.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Well, no foot at all
for the
Labour Council.
That's a
great idea. So I'd like to propose that we go with zero.
I'll spend a week.
Yeah. Anybody wants to go to the piece of one? Anybody wants to go to
There's a couple of things. I mean, yes, I think 0% is doable. Council have to realise that there are certain projects that they're talking about. I keep highlighting it. So the provision of the shelters and base, the hardwoods, the deeper development, the storage work. At the moment, the pond area, which is probably, we don't know for definitely the possibility of being rebuilt. Hopefully, that's going to come in under. And then, on top of that, I mean, I did get the CPI and RPI figures out, and it is jumping. But nobody's got this fall, and it might settle down by next year. But I mean, the predictions are that it's expected to last for about 2 years. The CPI is 4.8. Yeah, so you really want 7.5. That came out today.
But we're all people in the toilet for 300, and there's still a lot to talk about.
Yeah. So all I'm saying is just
be aware.
Yeah.
In the
light of
that,
I'm just saying be aware.
Yeah, but you know, even doing what you said is right, because that will create something of forecast. The income tax for us, for the council as a whole, is 4,000 pounds. But then we are actually increasing, okay? So it's directly more increase, that will be better.
So we kind of
propose
in the simple.
Yeah, so that's actually it's all right then.
So you need to vote on that one.
Yeah, we will. So there was actually a.
Can we vote on what was proposed?
So
those in favour of 0% increase?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. More.
Yeah, 5%. 4.99%.
4.99%.
So she includes the base. If I say, I mean, you know, about 58p, we get the total cost of
that.
Yeah, which is not so much. But one of the things which we need to do, we don't have to be very important, is unemployment is down, employee numbers are up to record numbers, and then the pre-pandemic. And vacancies are rising in the report. The vacancies are actually also over. And the jobs plan is broken. So we don't have a B, and we are actually the best performing economy in the market, which is safe.
And the only way we get money is get the human employee.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this
well,
is
well, the other thing that with Christmas is coming directly for Canada.
Yeah, let's move on. Do you want to go? Well, it's meaning the proposal.
So,
we
I've
got to go now, Chair.
Is it?
Thank you,
Brian.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah.
So 14.3, renewal of all sites, keep holding security contract.
Yeah, so you have that in your agenda pack, so I have been out and I've got a lot of posts actually. So our officer recommendation is to continue with their current provider, which is the one I want, who are often the best value of money, and also to opt for a 3-year fixed term contract, again, such as best value of money. So we're also recommending that in line with financial regulation level 6, in light of the low value of the total
many times do you call these people?
I think they've been about four times
a year.
Yeah.
So this is actually, they're only our case.
Yes. They have been reliable. They have
okay.
been very reliable, yeah.
Okay, any proposal at second or fourth person right now?
I think the proposal I would suggest is that if you want to go with the same team, keep the yearly contract. It just means that sadly Rachel's got to do 3 months.
Because otherwise we have to process payments for...
And that's what you get paid for. I'm sorry. I'm absolutely sorry. If you pay for it up front, if that company goes bust, you've lost that money. Just for the sake of being in having an easy point to give them a loan or a phone.
What is the monthly finance process? Well, there's no change in price. I did get that. I did ask whether there was any cost. In the third column, the difference in cost is paid monthly rather than every upfront.
So
there's no change in that.
You keep those money in jeopardy by doing that. And you keep doing it.
We go for the same contract but paying in three installments.
Okay, yeah. So what is it?
I know.
Well, we don't even pay money anyway. Yeah.
Not
that yeah, so it's only year
it's only
per year.
No,
just
per year up front.
Because it's but loan point six, all the contracts will not be paid up front and but we be paid upon the receipt of an invoice, either on a quarterly basis, unless in case it's present to the council. So that this is an exception. Right now, Sharon and us for an exception, unless we have to go according to the invoice. So I feel that we stick with the invoice, that will be the better way, because that's what we agree. That's what Franklin also mentioned.
But not all for the 3 years, one of
them. Well, 3 years.
They said they're going to get 3 invoices.
Yeah. So that is actually, I said this, that is actually a method of voting, rather upfront. Which Tony also.
That's not what Tony's saying.
Tony's saying a different one. That's a three, he doesn't want 3 year contracts to go in.
And I already proposed.
Yeah, so it's that, but it's whether you want whether you're happy for us to pay £600 for the year, or whether you want that split through the 12 months and us process every month.
No, 600 for a year.
Yeah.
shown as 200 in
No, that's
a building.
A building.
Okay, so are you happy to actually amend that your proposal according to the house?
I'm not sure. What are we amending?
So it's a 3-year fixed contract with a contract being paid up for 1 year.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
Yeah.
I'm happy for that.
Just
for the taxes money, or sorry,
constituents'
money in jeopardy.
Okay, right now, let's have the vote. Right now, we have to decide on that. Okay, we'll have the vote in a second. All in favour for Andy's proposal? Against?
Okay, so we sent out an invitation for quotes, and we contacted five fireworks companies, and we had responses from three of the five. So Dynamite Fireworks are the company that started 2021 display. Who's used fireworks last year?
So we have three quotes. I think there's a slight difference between the quotes between 4,300 and 4,100. Then the other one is 6,000. Fully fused also done with works for us. Yeah. Okay.
Sure, display it for 25% less fireworks. 15 minutes instead of 20.
Yeah, but there are time limits actually. But right now, let's go for the cheapest and most
economical.
Yeah,
and they've done it before. They're closest to us.
They were really good too. They were working on it. I was at the top of them. And they were very keen and they wanted to do the best for us.
And they're coming at a good promise.
Yeah.
So that's 4,000. Do you want to go for this again? You want to go for a 1 year contract or 3 year contract? 3 year contract has a £200 difference, £200 difference on that.
I mean, things are only going to get an awful lot more expensive in the next few years, aren't they?
Well, that's substitution,
isn't it?
No, but
everything goes up.
I think
we've
got
enough
Sorry. Roger's been saying that since 2007, but we haven't finished. We haven't
shared
that.
But you know, Sam was
We discussed and finished on board.
Right now, this the question is here. As chair, let's complete this one. But I feel the 3 year because of the increase in prices. But Tony, on this one, I sometimes disagree because it only goes up and that way.
Everything goes up.
Yeah.
And that's why we budget for things to go up.
Because it's only £200 difference, but
yeah,
every year it goes up.
You know, £600 savings.
Yeah.
I mean, if it goes up, right, even 10%.
Are
you
going
to do PEL up front for free?
No.
It's
no
longer
up front.
Is it easier for the admin?
No, not at all.
Okay, so what's the proposal? The recommendation is to go with the distribution.
Dynamite.
dynamite fire for your pavilion.
No, I'm not.
So, anybody to propose and second? I haven't asked chair, why should I propose? Okay, it comes to the council. Yeah, and something to second.
What's the proposal?
So, to go with the dynamite
for
a fixed price.
Is that, Terry? So that's a proposal and second.
No, I'm still deciding. No, I'm not saying.
Oh, all
right. I'm still having to say.
Okay.
I'm
going
to think we should be in the contract, just in case, as we discussed at the last meeting, we're trialing back to the banks, and it may be that we want to try again back to something else.
That's what we've decided. And the thing
decided
is,
for a year.
Yeah, but one of the things, I was the one writing the silence one, and that's why we tried. And there was a we got response right now. We got what the feedback was. And many people were not interested. So we had decided that we would go back to the.
Where did you get the feedback?
So you push through Facebook.
Let me propose 1 year. First one. 1 year. Yeah, for the first one.
Okay. Right now, 3 year is the one that, and it was anybody to second that part? Anybody to second?
3 year. Second,
second, and
three year. Oh, Ben. There's a right now a proposal for dynamite fireworks, 3 year fixed contract for 3 years. All in favor?
All in favor.
Anyone in favor of 3 year contract? Straight away.
Five.
Okay.
1 year contract.
I'm going to put it
against.
Two abstain.
So it's been kept.
Yeah.
That's been kept. Okay. So let's go to the next one because.
Can you just.
Continue the meeting for another half an hour. Not half an hour. After 10 o'clock, we have to vote. Yeah. Vote for continuing the meeting.
Continue.
Let's go to the post to repair roofway activities and the car park lights.
Okay, so the problem with the electricity supply is the light on outside of the supply.
How much?
There are only 3 lights working on the car park and out the supply. At night, this is presenting a danger for our site fire. We've identified the problems on the ground.
Why
do
we want it put in the first place? But I'll take advantage of that. So. Let's move on, get this prepared.
Okay.
Anybody, all those in favour?
Additional table maintenance to what was it the last
Okay, any questions? No, any councillors would like to actually know?
Have we not got a paper showing?
No, we bring someone in because they dispose of it as well.
If we shred it, we don't have a only disposal.
It's
highly
shredded. Yeah, and they recycle.
But if we bought our own cross shredder so that it shreds its weights, nobody would actually paste that together again to know exactly what that is. We'd put it in a bin.
How much do you have? Because it is time consuming.
It is.
Yeah. And it's recycled. That's the other thing about it. It's just very
there. We can recycle it.
Yeah, well, that's just
Second.
Motion to table more in the next election.
Are you in agreement? Move to the next week.
No. No, I was happy to do this.
Happy. Finally, so you close the gate. Jerry?
No, I think so. I'm actually done now.
Two against, one abstention.
Abstention or against?
Two against.
Against, yes.
Because that is March. Because that's an important matter, that's not a small matter. 15.2, appointment of these people to do an emergency or air operations based forum. I'm happy to do this, like, for an error, I can do that, or do that, or do that, or do that, or do that.
Second,
so, those in favour? Okay, 15.3 we already covered.
Yeah.
So next 16, that's for the thing for the total meetings. 26 days planning and bonding meeting. And I'm 14 days, 11 days is second March. Thank you very much.
Yeah.